it's a good idea that when you're setting up your batches, at least at the beginning, to look at the different recovery options and pick what's best for your situation. You have three options. You can either recover nothing. That simply means when the interface stops and then restarts, it will just start up new when it starts and will not pay attention to recovering anything. Or you can recover everything, batch, unit batch, and sub-batch level. That is the default. Or you can recover only PIBatches and unit batches. And the default time, as we said earlier, is 4 days. This is just a random number that we picked. It may or may not work for you. We attempt to recover the data every time the PIBaGen interface is shut down and restarted, or when you register a PI unit, we will go back and try to recover the data from your process data. How is it different from runtime? Well, the big difference is that runtime, the interface looks at snapshot values, and if you're in a data recovery mode, we look at archive data. That's data that's stored in the archive. And the big difference between snapshot and archive data is the compression process. You want to make sure that on your trigger tags especially, you have compression set where you're not filtering out meaningful trigger values. So it's important to check your compression settings on all of your active points or trigger tags. You are limited to recovering data only to the last data found. You cannot recover data for a specific period in the past. So if your interface stopped and then started and you notice that you have a 1 day gap somewhere in the past, you're not allowed to recover just that 1 day. If you don't recover anything, we just simply start up when the new batch, unit batch starts up. Everything starts new. It's useful when recovery is not important and it reduces startup time for your interfaces. If you are concerned with the load on your system, you can choose to recover only PI batches and unit batches. This will not recover sub batches. And there are some logic that goes along with these particular recovery options. Let's look at some of that logic here. Let's say we have a closed PI unit batch and the interface is shut down. We then see some more information come into our system before the interface starts up. And that shutdown period actually is 8 days. And so if we leave the default recovery time of 4 days, we will recover a certain number of values, but not other values. If our recovery time had been 10 days, we would have recovered all the batch information across this entire period. Alternately, if there is a running PI batch when the interface is shut down and the data comes in over the same 8 day period, even though the recovery time is 4 days, we will recover all the events because there was a running PI batch. Sometimes it's not a good idea just to rely on the fact that there was a running PI batch, but to increase your recovery time to what you think is reasonable when you might notice that the batch interface is down. Here we have an example of a recovery situation where we have a running unit batch and a running sub batch. The active point is a stepped tag, and we are in the middle of our first sub batch running under our unit batch. As we watch it progress, the unit batch continues. We're into our second sub batch when the interface gets shut down. As the situation progresses, we see that the second sub-batch stopped and the third sub-batch was created, but we missed that because the interface was down. When the interface restarts, the unit batch is closing out. Now, if we look at the recovery time as the unit of time that the interface was shut down, we need to go back and look at what happens when we recover that data. Because we have to go to the archive to recover it, the compression deviation is important. How much data did we filter out using the compression algorithm? Well, if the compression deviation is 1, then we should have recorded all of the step progressions, and we should be able to rebuild the sub-batch structure correctly. However, the default compression deviation is 2. And if the default compression deviation is 2, when we go back and rebuild our subbatch mechanism, we're only going to see when the value changes from 0 to 2. We miss the 1 that is the intermediary step. And so this unit batch will be reconstructed as if it only had one subbatch and not the correct 3 subbatches. So you need to be very careful when you're setting up your trigger mechanisms with regard to your recovery options. You need to make sure the compression deviation is ideally less than your active points increments or movements.